Rachel and Beck when they're down, and that's absolutely wonderful. There's also a lot of history with the Jansons, as you've heard. I kind of married into a lot of history and learned afterwards. And there should have been a caveat about that at the time. But sometimes you get real gems when you marry in. So I just wanted to share with you a little bit today about SIM. Yes, but in a more specific sense, about people. So I work for SIM. I am currently the regional director for SIM for South Australia, Western Australia, Northern Territories. Up until recently, that job belonged to another person named Alan Milhouse, who you may or may not be familiar with. He has now begun a role as a lead of a new ministry that's operating here in Australia, facilitating return missionaries and diaspora to minister to unreached peoples here in Australia. So we're taking a look at saying, what have we learned working all over the world? And how can we use that to reach those people from all over the world that have come here? So that is an absolutely incredible thing. And so he stepped into that, and I've stepped into very big shoes. But part of my role as the regional director is to help churches stay in touch with the missionaries they support, and also to help them engage with the missions world that SIM has access to. Through this church, you supported the Smiths, which is an absolutely incredible relationship. And you have been generous and consistent over the years with your support of the Smith family in Mozambique. And that's an incredible thing. And sometimes it gets really hard to keep this understanding of who these people are when they spend so many years very far away. Sometimes you see them as they come through on one home assignment or another. So I figured I would try my very best to try and bring them here today. So I hoodwinked them into doing a whole bunch of videos so that I could bring them to you today so you can get a little taste of what it's like to be the Smiths in Mozambique right now.
Okay. Let's see how this works.
Last year went really well. We go around to here. We've actually planted this side with maize already. Most people think that I'm crazy for planting already, but it's actually okay, and it will do well. But we've already had 2 weeks of that rain. And over there, and turn around, is the new accommodation centre we're building to train up people for Foundations for Farming. And to the right of that is the shelter, where we're going to be doing the training. So we've actually started training already this year. We've done one training with coronavirus. We weren't allowed to train up until last week. We were able to train last week for the first time, and we did a training with about 36 people, I think, and it went really well. And we're doing another training this week, and then we're going to do some training out here. But the aim is, what we're really trying to work on at the moment is to teach others how to teach. So I'm actually training a heap of people. I'm taking 6 people out with me training this week. So right now I'm standing around my vegetable patch, in my vegetable patch. I think it's one of the keys to what we teach around here, and that's getting better nutrition to the people. So this is just my vegetable patch producing for our family, but we've taught people how to grow cabbages and other things so much better, and how to make a profit from it, but also how to feed their families and give better nutrition to their families through the vegetable patch.
Hi girls, how are you?
Good.
You're good? What are you doing? You're actually being naughty, aren't you? Because your dad told you not to get up there.
I'm up here.
So what do you like to do? What fun things do you do around here? Play?
Play.
Yeah, you play. Do you do sometimes?
Yeah.
What's your favourite thing to do in school?
Art.
Art. So school for you is art. If you haven't done art, you haven't been to school.
There's
a little
bubble down there.
Okay, say see you to everyone.
Bye.
Bye. Hi, Ethan. What are you up to?
Well, I'm doing work, school, and math,
which you love. Tell me what things you do around here for fun.
Well, I like to be in my treehouse and looking after my cat and my chickens and the dog, and also eating mangoes from the mango trees.
Which are nearly ripe. What about riding your bike? You like doing that as well?
Yeah, I like riding down the big hill.
Hi Liam, what's up to you?
I'm doing Bible for school.
Okay, because you're doing school online because of coronavirus. So
yes.
How long does it take to do school each day?
Most of the day.
And then what do you do if you get time? What do you do apart from school?
I like to make YouTube videos, but I don't get much time to do it because of school.
Alright.
We just want to say a little bit about what our life has looked like since we've returned and just how thankful we are that we have returned.
Yeah, so it's definitely good to be back home in Moz, and especially to be back with Liam. So it's been good having him at home. He's been doing school online, so it's meant that we can have him with us, which is really good. The only thing is that COVID has kind of caused our ministry, to look a little bit different. So we haven't been able to go to the church at all, or do kids club because of the restrictions.
And up until just last week, we haven't been able to do any work in Foundations for Farming except for on our place.
Yeah, so that's just started up again where Andrew's doing some courses in town with different groups.
And in other villages around the place.
So when we got back, we kind of felt a little bit discouraged, just with life, I guess. So we were kind of just praying for different opportunities to come up for ministry, especially focused specifically on this village. And one of our workers' wives brought her child along, and she had these really bad burns on her arms and her legs. And she'd been to the witch doctor, and they'd done something to her and stuck on rabbit fur on her burns and everything, but it just wasn't healing.
Rabbit fur with tree sap to glue it on.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to get off. But anyway, so I might say, oh no, I can't really help go to the hospital, but this time I just felt like this is an opportunity. So my house help, Lucia, and I every day just started cleaning her burns, and it was every day for a fair few weeks, and just cleaning it with salt water and putting aloe vera on, and actually she really healed up very quickly, and as a result of that, her mum decided that she wanted to become a Christian and be baptised. So she must have had some kind of background in Christianity, I guess. But anyway, so we baptised her, and from that we've started doing a Bible study twice a week in our yard, and with her coming, and also for our workers. So it's been a real opportunity just to kind of mentor and disciple her as a new Christian, and also some of our workers don't even know Jesus yet. So it's been a really good opportunity. It's been pretty tough time this year for us, not just with COVID, but also, you know, missing really important events in our lives, like Talia and Rue's wedding. It was a big, was sad for me. Oh, it was sad for you.
Yes.
Sad for me. Yeah, and now we've just found out that Talia and Rue are having a baby in May, so that's put another, it's exciting, but it's put another spanner in the works.
So really trying to work out when we can come home.
Yeah, so we would love to be able to come home. We've got Shanae's 21st at the end of January, and we'd just like to have some sort of a wedding celebration too. Not sure how that will work out. But so we'd really value your prayers just to know when, or if we can come home, when we should come home, and
how we can work it out with Liam's school.
Yeah, and hopefully Liam can still do school online so that makes it possible for us. So anyway, we just value your prayers, we value your support. Yeah, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
things are going over there. Coronavirus has taken a very different shape in different places, and for them it has meant a lot of sitting with open hands and saying, God, what would you have us do? And God has said, here are things I'll have you do. Here's discipleship, and here's praying together with people, and working in small groups instead of big groups, which has been incredible and such a blessing. I don't know if you have kept up to date with what's been going on with them, but at the beginning of the pandemic, their son Liam was at boarding school in Kenya, and they were actually in South Africa seeking medical treatment for their two youngest daughters who were quite sick. And the boarding school decided that they would shut down and send everyone home within the space of about 3 days, hoping that they could get the kids back to their families before international borders closed, and thinking that they would be returning quite quickly to Mozambique. Liam headed straight back to Mozambique to wait for the family there to return from South Africa. Unfortunately, the borders closed much quicker than they anticipated, and they ended up spending quite a few months living in South Africa while Liam lived with another family in Mozambique. And it took a lot of work, a lot of persistence, a lot of creativity, and most of all, a lot of prayer for them to get back into Mozambique and together as a family. Their two oldest daughters live over here, adult daughters, and I think the conditions of feeling separated are even more acute right now with everything that's going on. So that video was shot 3 weeks ago, and since then they have been given clearance to return to Australia. So right now the huge prayer point for them is, first of all, the logistics of actually getting back into Australia. There's waiting lists you have to be on, you have to be given permission by multiple levels of people in multiple positions in multiple governments. And then you have to be able to afford it, and then you have to actually get on a flight that actually goes all the way from point A to point Z, wherever it is that we are. So there's a lot of things that have to fall into place and continue on for that actually to be possible. We're hoping that they'll return in February, if all things work out the way that we are anticipating. And then specifically prayer for Liam. He is still attending Rift Valley Academy, based in Kenya. They have been online up until recently. They've said that they will go back into in-person classes in January. So it is a question of whether they'll be able to maintain online school for some kids and in-person school for the other kids. So those are the huge prayer points right now for the Smith family. I know they would really appreciate your partnership in prayer. It's a whole new song and dance, but really in the international world, it's the same song and dance with different titles. A lot of these complications are things that we've seen before when war breaks out or when a government collapses. And so in some ways, we're very familiar with this. In other ways, we've never had it affect a country like Australia in the same way. So that's a new challenge. So as you think of the Smiths, I would really encourage you to pray over that situation, that God would make it possible to bring them home. So, SIM is, we say serving in mission, but it's not really what we're called anymore, which is an interesting thing. We've kept the acronym, but we've changed so many times that now we're just SIM. But we do serve in mission, although mission is regularly looking different in different places as opportunities change, as world expectation changes, as governments have different laws, and we need to adapt, and our language adapts with us. So we are serving in the kingdom. We are serving for the kingdom, and that's from anywhere to everywhere. We are a mission organization that has over 4,000 mission workers in over 70 different countries, sent from over 60 different countries. So we're not really an Australian organization, or a Korean organization, or a Canadian organization. We are a world organization. And so that's an absolute pleasure to be a part of, and to be a part of the multicultural teams that are an effect of that. So I wanted to share a little bit with you about my journey with SIM. And why it is that I believe so ardently that this is something that God has called all of us to. So I guess my journey with SIM starts long before I was born, which is, I know it happens. I didn't have a lot to say in that part. My grandparents were missionaries with SIM in Ethiopia. My father was born over there, along with his three siblings. He went back to Canada for university and met my mother, who is the child of missionaries as well. Yeah, you can see where this is going. I'm like three generations of confused. My mom's parents were missionaries in the Northern Territories of Canada amongst the Inuit people. So God has a really good sense of humor. Let's see. Africa, Northern Canada, sounds good. Yeah. So that's my start. When I was 5 years old, my family returned to Ethiopia to serve long term. So that's where I grew up. And I went to boarding school at the age of 8. I was kind of last of the baby boarders. Back in the day, that was the thing. So that was kind of my life. And then at 16, I moved back to Canada on my own, found a place, got a job, finished school, and then went on to university. And so the missions world, as I know it, has changed a lot through my lifetime. That's no longer generally the format that we use. We have options, we have choices. Kids can do school 5 different ways without leaving home. Isn't that incredible? Some kids, they need the boarding school because, oh man, it's so hard living without any friends. Like that's a real life issue. How many kids can thrive in isolated situations? So it is definitely a changing world that we're a part of. I come from this world, and it's been a strange world, but it's a world where this concept of church is very diverse. First of all, from tromping all over the place in Canada and in the U.S. as we visited our supporting churches, and we came in and visited churches like you and said, "Hi, we're the compells. This is what we do. Thank you for partnering with us." So we do the loop, and 50 different churches in a year's time, and realizing, wow, there is a lot of different ways to love Jesus. And it comes in different colors, and it comes in different buildings, and it comes in different types of music, and it comes in different ways of playing it out. And then traveling to other parts of the world and realizing it comes in different languages, it comes in different shapes, it comes in different heart understandings of what God's saying to us through the scripture. That's an incredible thing to grow up with. It did take a little while into my adult years to realize that was a blessing. We all go through that of, God, why? Oh, that's why. This blessing that I've been given, this chance to peek into, be an observer in so many different contexts, be a watcher, and see God's church operate and live all over the world. That has been such a privilege. So I want to share a little bit with you about how SIM does that. So I've got a little bit of a video to share with you.
If time were a book, and you could turn back its pages to trace the threads of history back to its humble beginnings, you might see that the apparently coincidental might rather be the notes of a symphony played out on a celestial scale. As far back as 1860, missionaries were working in the Middle East who would form the roots of today's Middle East Christian outreach, and in 1889, Murray, Osborne and Walton would found the South Africa General Mission. Unknown to anyone at the time, these would be the opening notes of something quite remarkable. The year is 1893. British evangelists visit South America and publish a book that God would use to call George and Mary Allen of New Zealand to sail to the other side of the world and found the Bolivian Indian Mission. That same year, Charles Reeve of Tasmania forms the Pune and India Village Mission, recognizing Pune as an important hub for reaching traveling Hindu pilgrims. On November 3rd, a Scottish pearl trader arrives in the island of Ceylon to minister to its people under the name of the Ceylon and India Mission, And exactly a month and a day later, on December 4th, 1893, three friends from North America land on the shores of Nigeria with a vision to bring the gospel to the unreached millions south of the Sahara Desert. They called it the Sudan Interior Mission, an organization which over a century later would exist as a partnership of all of these disparate mission organizations spread out across the planet, from Africa to Asia, from the Indian subcontinent to South America, and from Europe to the Middle East. Man has neither the comprehension nor the imagination to script stories so ambitious, let alone the power to act it out through the very lives of the thousands upon thousands woven into it. It is these that make up a story that 125 years later would result in a global collective united by a common heart, that nobody should live and die without hearing the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ.
SIM exists because we are convinced that no one should live and die without hearing God's good news. Therefore, we believe that He has called us to make disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ in communities where He is least known.
Two days apart. and Carol, in her love, prayed that Tom would find a wife. Yeah. And his mom did too, so it's two of them. But we had no hope, really. But the interesting thing is, I tell people, you know what, yes, it definitely worked out for us, but there's a whole lot easier ways to meet people. Yeah. But that's how God decided to bring us together. We've served in different places in South Sudan. I finished my term first and returned to Canada. Tom then returned and finished his term. And then had a layover in Canada. So, you know, here's the world. There's South Sudan. Here's Canada. Here's Australia. So he did, yeah, layover, right? Yeah. And we sat down and we said, you know what? We're both decided that our lives are going to be committed to following God. And we reckon that we can do that together. And so we ventured out on that. I came down to meet all of the family that were very terrified to meet this random person that Tom had picked up somewhere, you know, in Africa on his travels. I think they're okay with me now. It's been about 8 years, but I think we're getting there. And I was brought into this incredible family of community down here, which was an absolute privilege. And then shortly after Tom and I were married, we got a call from a project in Ethiopia, just south of the capital, a rest and conference center aimed at missionaries and local church leaders, saying, how can we encourage, how can we uplift, and how can we care for these people who are in full-time ministry in Ethiopia? And so we went and we spent 2 years there, helping to reboot that program that had been shut down because of a very, very long list of reasons, one including the government thought it was a very nice looking place and they were trying to have it back. And so that once that was up and running again, we returned here to Australia and said, okay, God, that was good, now what? And thus began our journey with the Home Office. I think that's the point of the conversation where it comes in to say, you know, why is it? Why is it that we do what we do? And I'm amazed because, you know, we come here and it's been a lovely drive up, but we didn't plan with everybody else in the service. And yet, how about that prayer time this morning? How directed was that? God is, you know, when God wants to say something, he doesn't just say it once, does he? No, he'll say it again, and he'll say it again, and he'll say it again. This is the incredible thing. When God wants us to understand something, he's going to keep telling us. I just love this way that we are part of a whole. We're part of a whole. We're not actually all these separate pieces. We're actually one part of a much larger whole. And when we think about the world that we live in, we think about least reach people here. We think about least reach people all over the world. God's given you guys a role here to play. And he's also given you a role in the world. And just as he has given a role to every other church of people that love him and are seeking to do what he is asking of them. I love the passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Corinthians is crazy because Paul is, he's writing a couple of letters, right, to the church at Corinth. And the first letters that he writes are scathing. They're like, Paul's got this knack for like really sharp tongue. A little bit of sarcasm and a whole lot of and he has laid it on that church saying, you know, you are not living out the gospel that you were given. And it's this heavy, heavy first section. And that's what we call 1 Corinthians. And then we come to 2 Corinthians. And after this really strong chastisement of the church, 2 Corinthians is this invitation. It says, now come back to what you already have. Now come back into the relationship you've already been gifted. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, starting in verse 14, we have this incredible gem. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised. How incredible is that in a nutshell? Because of the gospel. Because Creator God came and lived amongst man in Christ. He lived with us, discipled, taught, was crucified, died, defeated death, rose again, and is seated at the right hand of God and is interceding on our behalf. Because of this, our lives are not our own. We can't live as we would if this was not the truth. This thing has completely changed who we are, what we are, and how we work. We are now something completely different. And he's saying this to a church that has struggled with sin, a church that he has cut down to the quick. He's saying, you. So there's no way to discount. There's no way to discount this word and say, oh, that's for those who have it together. That's for those who are really connected. Those are for the super Christians. Having lived with missionaries a long time, being raised by missionaries, I can tell you they're not super Christians. But they serve an amazing God. And that's where the difference comes in. Missionaries are not super Christians that have been called to super ministry. They're just people who love Jesus and have obeyed willingly and often brokenly as God forms and shapes and changes them in the same way he is interacting with his whole church. So there's this call into being a part of the story. And I love this incredible thing, the story. Because often we think, oh, you know, here's my story and I want to invite Jesus into my story. God, come be a part of my story. But that's actually not the invitation. He's not sitting there going, hi, can I come into your story? He's sitting there saying, you can come into mine. Come into my story. Step into my world. Become part of my church. Become part of my mission. God's mission is in every nation. God's mission is a global church. Every nation, tribe, and tongue. Are we stepping into God's story? There's this incredible fit factor amongst the church. When we gather together with those who are different from ourselves, who share the same faith but a different perspective, we learn, we grow, we become more of who we are meant to be. And I'm convinced that if we want to live to the fullness of being the church, we have to do it in relationship and awareness of the church global. That's a hard thing to do. How are we supposed to be connected with so many people all around the world? Global interaction is happening these days. And if you think about the thousands of people that are participating in that, and that's just one organization, that's incredible. How are we supposed to be connected with all of that? It starts with relationship. It starts with relating with someone. Relating with missionaries. It starts with prayer, interaction, giving time, supporting, journeying alongside, just as you are doing with the Smiths. This is part of it. This is building that bridge. This is becoming part of that whole. And that is the thing that I find absolutely astounding. We are a small part. And the more that we get involved with the world, the smaller we're going to feel. But the more we're going to realize we have a mighty God who is absolutely capable of transforming this world for his glory. So, after we finish up, I'll be at the back. I've got some literature, I've also got lots of stories. If you want to chat, please feel free to come and chat with me. I really enjoy that. I love talking about this stuff. Sometimes it's hard to get me to stop, but signals for that. and I would love to share with you if you are a supporter of an SIM project or another SIM missionary and you would like an update, please come and ask me, and if I know off the bat, I can give it to you, and if I need to go find it, I'll go find it. And I would love to have that interaction with you. But as I leave you today, I want to leave you with two things to think about. And these are things that I want you to take with write them down. If something comes to your mind as I ask you them, write it down. Take it with you. Don't let it pass away. The first thing is this question. How are you already connected to God's global church? And how can you share that with your community here? There's already these bridges being built. There's already these relationships starting. And how can you share that with one another? The second thing